And so I know what I'm talking about. And I have been involved in resolving conflicts between some multinational oil companies and communities. And therefore, I have gained practical insights into the work, inner workings of this social process. We take it for granted that when conflict occurs, it will just go away. No conflict goes away like that at all. And like I said, this is one soft skill you must understand. Develop the capacity so that when the opportunity comes to resolve the conflict, you don't panic. What you do is to do what we call know what is about to happen because before it happens. We call it conflict prevention. It's like those who do risk management. And so they know that if you set up a business, you know, something can go wrong. That's actually the definition of risk, the probability of something going wrong. Are there risk managers here? All of you should be risk managers. The probability that something can go wrong is called risk. But if you prepare yourself for risk, once something is about to go wrong, you will know what to do. That's the thing. So but let's go straight to our discussion this morning. And so my purpose this morning is to discuss the meaning of conflict and conflict resolution as a social process. And then to share some insights on the nature of conflicts in business, as well promote a shared understanding of conflict resolution strategies. Shared understanding. It means that in our various businesses, various organizations, various levels, you have experienced conflict. There is nobody here who has not experienced conflict. Is there anybody?
No.
Is there anybody?
No.
Good. In fact, in some trainings, we were always asked, what of personal conflict, internal conflict? So even if you are not experiencing conflict outside, you have also experienced conflict within yourself. We'll get to that. And I share some thoughts on capacity gaps, contradictions, challenges, and opportunities. Then I would like to receive feedback from participants based on your experiences. Next. These are my opening thoughts. Can two work together except they agree?
No.
It's a question. It's coming from the Bible. Can two work together except they agree?
No.
Can you do business together except you agree?
No.
I hope you know that. The Bible is the greatest book on earth. There is nothing, no knowledge, whether art, science, biology, astrology, there is nothing. Chemistry that you are researching, you are looking for, that you can't find the roots in the Bible. Absolutely not. Some of us have gone very far in researching some of these issues using the Bible as our test case. And so sometimes we flow back to the Word of God. And this is a simple question. Can two work together except they agree?
No.
It's not possible. One of my strong points is negotiation. Usually when I teach negotiation or when I negotiate, I found out that you cannot enter a shop, buy something, or let money leave your pocket unless there is an agreement. Two of us. That's the truth. So that's why the Bible was very clear here, asking this as a question, very rhetorical anyway, if you ask me. Two cannot work together except they agree. And then I had developed this some years ago, and I said, be careful that present victory does not contain the seeds of future problems. Be that present victory does not contain the seeds of future problems. This is very deep. This is deep. Sometimes you are doing something with people. You are relating with people. And you are not bothered about the interest of the other person. And you feel that you have won. And you feel that you have an upper hand. The person leaves the bargain or leaves that experience feeling cheated, feeling bad, feeling that he or she has lost out. You leave that bargain or that experience feeling very excited that you have won. But unknown to you, you have just lost a relationship. You have just lost a relationship. The next time you want to do the same business or another business with that person, the person tells you, I am not interested. You begin to tell yourself, why? Why are you not interested? What's the problem? This time around, we will do you fine, though. In fact, my people are ready to treat you very well. The person tells you, I am not interested. Because what happened before is still fresh in his or her memory. You didn't understand that victory you obtained planted a seed for future problems. So that's why we say, whatever you are doing, be very careful that present victory does not contain the seeds of future problems. Conflict is growth trying to happen. Ellen Hunt. Conflict is growth trying to happen. If we understand that you do not really know what is about to happen. If you know human nature, that inside us, we have the capacity for good and for bad, positive and negative. It's in our nature to tell lies, in our nature to disappoint. It's in our nature to disagree. It's in our nature to be angry. It's in our nature to be violent. It's in our nature to even behave in a way that is least expected. All these are encapsulated in human nature. But if you understand that when that experience comes, if you are very perceptive, as a person, regard it as opportunity for growth. You never understand certain things until conflict has taken place. True of us.
True.
In fact, in relationships between two people, you will never know what is in their heart. You will never know how far somebody can go unless there is conflict. It's at that point certain things are forbidden. It's at that point certain actions are taken. It's at that point that certain statements are made. And then you begin to understand the real nature of the person. It is also at that point that you understand that person's capacity for forgiveness. That person's capacity to tolerate you and your excesses. When conflict happens, it is an opportunity for growth. It opens a vista of learning. Something you have taken for granted, you will now know how not to, not how to, how not to do certain things. In my strategy class, I always teach that it is not to understand what to do. What is more important is to know what not to do. Do we get this?
Yeah.
The idea is not to know what to do. The idea is to know what not to do. Because time is of the essence. You can spend 2, 3, 4 hours doing doing what you are not supposed to do. Let me step this down because it leads me deeply into what I'm about to discuss with you. The Chinese have a proverb. That's the one, you know, Africans, we are very smart in getting the first part of the proverb. It says, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. We are always quoting that. If you want to win somebody over, he said, don't worry now, we are just starting. Don't worry, all these things are supposed to be there. We are on a journey. A journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. That's the only one we took about the proverb, the Chinese proverb. But the complete proverb says, a journey of 1,000 miles begins with one step. Make sure the first step is in the right direction. Because you know you can travel 1,000 miles in the wrong direction. True of us. True. So that's why forums like these, platforms like these are very important. Very, very important. Look at every Saturday, every time this platform is called, you make out the time to come and share knowledge. What you do not understand. Even what you understand, you need to understand it from another person's perspective. It's very important. Because that is what will enable you to manage difficult situations. Because in life, whether you like it or not, difficult situations will arise. It doesn't matter whether you pray for 2 hours, 1 hour, 3 hours, or whether you speak in tongues. The test, the true test of you as even a spiritual person is your capacity to remain calm when there are difficult situations. Let's go fast. Conflicts. Let's see if we can understand this. Human beings are creatures of work. You know, we're applying this to business. Because conflict is a very wide area. So we are restricting ourselves to business. Because when you enter the marketplace, a lot of things happen. In fact, they say that it is not the tongue or the language with which people borrow money that they pay it. True or false?
Absolutely true.
Absolutely. He said absolutely. You know. So when you enter the marketplace, a lot of bargains take place. When somebody is trying to do business with you, at the beginning, the language he or she uses is different from the language when that business is in full motion and when that business is about to end. Often, friends become enemies at the end of the day. But a knowledge of conflict resolution enables you to know what not to do. What not to do. What not to do. That's the idea. Many people know what to do, but they do not know what not to do. And look at how it is. There is this thing they say, love your neighbor as yourself. The other one say, God, do unto others as you will let them do unto you. That's the Christian version. But the Hindu version is more effective. The Hindu version says, do not do unto others what you will not like them to do unto you. That one is more effective. Very effective. Because it's very easy for people to take certain things for granted. Let's go. And so to lead, they must work. To work, they must develop capacity. And this capacity enables them to enter into social relations of production. Social relations of production. You are business people. In business transactions, conflict occur. True or false?
True.
In these conflicts lie the understanding of our true relations, mindset, interests, and needs. These are the key words. This presentation can be taken from my people here. You can take it, okay. So you can digest it. Okay? Go back to that slide. Now, the operational goals here are, in these conflicts lie the understanding of our true relations, mindsets, interests and needs. Because in a family, the interest of a child is different from the interest of the husband, of the wife, of your brothers, of your neighbors, two of us. It is only through conflict that you are able to know, oh, this is why this man is defending this thing. This is why this woman is defending this thing. But their husband and wife, why are they not seeing it from the same perspective? They cannot see it from the same perspective because our differences enable us to see things differently. We are different. If you are not a man, you are a woman. If you are not a boy, you are a girl. If you are not an adult, you are a youth. So that difference alone enables you to have different needs and to see life from different perspectives. And so when situations occur, you are also looking at things differently. And the positions you take and the interests are quite different. Sometimes these interests and positions clash. But human conflict resolution skill teaches us that if we are to exist peacefully in a social space, we must develop the capacity to resolve our conflicts so that we can achieve our goals. Next. So, in the society, you have people as community, you have organizations and companies, then you have resources and assets, and then you have transactions. This is basically what is going on in our world. That you have people who are in a community. Now we have virtual communities, two of us.
True.
We have virtual online communities. We have communities of practice. We have religious communities. We have Muslim communities. We have political communities. We have economic communities. Not just ethnic communities. We exist within a geographical space that is littered with all kinds of complex social configurations. That if you are not careful, you do not know when the energy from one community moves into your own space and disorganizes you. Do you know that organized crime is very active in this state? Do you know that? Do you know that cultism is a community?
Yes.
Do you know that they are very active?
Yes.
Do you know that they have structures? Do you know that?
Very well.
So if you do not understand some of these things, you may just think that the next person you are doing business with is just a human being. It's not just a human being. He belongs to certain communities that also determine the way he responds to you.
Yes.
And of course, there are resources and assets, both natural and man-made. And from these resources and assets, we have transactions. And inside these transactions, people must win and people must lose. That's when conflict takes place. Next. Now, this tells us about the dark side of life and the light side of life. So the light that shines on darkness is peace. Whenever you have peace of mind, there's a kind of light. The energy inside you is light. Whenever you are doing business with people, somebody just shared an experience now, a testimony. He said, the person who refused to give them a document after something, you know, some engagement, was the same person who still released the document. At that time, when there was friction, there was a kind of darkness. The energy that was being released was dark energy. But the moment that document was released, there was a kind of peace, a kind of light. And the communication became very free. Don't take these things for granted. They are so small. They are so minute. It takes you to develop your inner mind and your inner sight to recognize when things are about to develop. When even that somebody who said no can say yes at the end. We have the strategies. That somebody, of course, for those of you who do marketing, sales, and all that, you will receive a lot of no's at the beginning, two of us.
That's correct.
People will tell you, no, I'm not interested. But if you know how to break the person's psychological barriers, and then you are able to move in, that same person who says no will be able to say yes. And then you close the deal. There are women, there are men who know how to sell. Selling is a skill, it's a soft skill.
Yes, yes, yes.
And if you are a businessman and you do not know how to sell, you need to go back to the school of selling. You need to know how to sell. Because if you cannot sell something, you shouldn't be in business. So selling is not something you say, my own is only to invent, or my own, I am an ideas man. My own is just ideas. Let me tell you, your lack of capacity to sell that idea can also cripple your own idea.
Yes.
That's the truth. So one of the greatest skills you will possess as a human being is your capacity to sell. It's not this thing we talk about network marketing, this, that. Selling is something that goes on naturally from you. You know, the way you dress, the way you address people, the way you conduct your business and all that. There is what is called subliminal marketing or subliminal publicity or subliminal advertising. That means the unconscious process of making somebody to change his or her mind based on the way you are presented. They call it subliminal because the person is acting on your consciousness. I don't want to buy this thing. There's a kind of way the person will present it to me, and then I say, okay, maybe I'll talk to my wife about it. Don't worry, I'll talk to my wife about it. The moment that statement comes out of his mouth, he's close to buying it. True of us. But you know, you need to know how to get him to make such a statement if it's a product that the family has to use. That's it. So, now, a stable relationship requires first peaceful coexistence. Conflicts are normal and natural. They are normal and natural. Okay? What is abnormal is violent conflicts. Violent conflict is abnormal. Why is it abnormal? Because it distorts the social process. It creates disharmony. It creates tension. It makes us to delve into the dark side of our lives. Sometimes we regret the actions that we take when we go violent. Haven't you seen in our experience as a society where students who are protesting about the marginalization or the increase of school fees, instead of understanding how to engage management, school authority, instead of doing non-violent direct demonstration, the moment they are out, they start looting, they start destroying, including the cars of passers-by, those who have no business in the conflict, they start to destroy, even the shops of those that sell on campus. You misdirect your anger and yet you want the conflict to resolve. Of course, trust school management. Sometimes they say, as you are returning, when they close down the school, they will say, as you are returning back, you are paying a fee of 20,000 for all the things you destroyed. So that next time you will not do that again. So that's why we say violent conflict is abnormal. Next. What is conflict? Because there is a need for us to understand what it means if we must understand the strategies. So we say that conflict is a disagreement between two or more people within a social, political, economic, or geographical space arising from differences in goals, interests, and needs. It's a disagreement between people within a space. That space must be defined. Is it a social space? Husband and wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, brother and sister? Or is it an economic space? Is it a business relationship? Is it a political space? We just witnessed one in this state recently. True or false? A very big one. When all the elections were conducted, and results with this, that of River State was hanging. The whole world was watching our own political conflicts. And of course, the dramatic facade, that is characters, were well known.
Yes.
And these conflicts arise from differences in goals, interests, and needs. Because what I want, what I need, may not necessarily be what you need. I want to buy this thing for 1,000 naira. You want to sell it for 1,500. But you do not have the capacity to convince me to give it to you for 1,000. But I have the capacity to try to cajole you or to even take a stand. If it is not 1,300, don't worry. Do you know that sometimes customers and marketers used to clash and quarrel?
Yes.
Do you know that?
Yes.
I did some work in Yoruba land when I was working as a journalist. Sometimes you go to the market, it's not only restricted to Yoruba land, apologies to Yoruba land. Sometimes you go to the market and you price a product that is way below what it is supposed to be, and the angry trader replies you, "Olosh." What's Olosh? What's the meaning of Olosh?
Thief.
Thief. So, do you know why he or she reacted that way? Because he or she cannot imagine that this thing that even you can't buy it 500, you are saying, give it to me 80 naira or 100 naira. And he says, "Olosh, thief." This is somebody who wants to make you to buy. Do you know that you can go to another shop and price the same product the same way, and the person with a smile calls you, "Come on, hey, don't do like that. This thing is not, it's not online like that." Do you know that?
Yes.
It happens. The Chinese people say that if you cannot smile, don't open a shop.
Right.
If you don't know how to smile, or if you cannot smile, don't open a shop. Conflict breaks down communication and reduces the quality of the relationship if not managed appropriately. True or false?
True.
Whether it's between a husband and a wife, that one is very, for those of you who are married here, you know that once there is a conflict in your relationship, the first thing that suffers is what? Communication. Communication breaks down. Good morning. What is good about the money? What is good about the money? So you know, a lot of things happen. A lot of things. So the first thing that suffers is communication. Therefore, we teach, we practice that you must improve your communication capacity in any environment you find yourself, so that you can reduce the level of conflict all the time. Some weeks ago, I traveled to Warwick and I lodged in a hotel in the morning, because I don't usually eat in the morning like that. I have my tea, I drink tea, and I like to eat foods. So I found out that the light in the room wasn't so good any morning. I wanted to eat. So I called the guy Dan, and the guy was very hostile. He said, "Oga, I'm the only one here. There's nothing I can do about the light." I said, "But can you send somebody to come and change?" He said, "There's nobody here. There's nothing I can do. I've told you my mind." He banged the phone on me. I was very angry. I said, "This guy must be very stupid." I didn't go down. After some time, about 3-4 hours later, just opened the windows and I used the light on. I went down. So I met the guy. And I was inquiring about other things. I calmed down. I started engaging him. I didn't, because it was a phone call, he didn't know whom he was talking to. I didn't refer to the experience. I told him that, "Can you give me water to take my green tea?" That was in the morning we had an altercation. He said, "There's nobody in the kitchen." He started being tough again. You know, nobody in the kitchen, the person in the kitchen has gone to the market, this and that and that and that and that. Then I answered, "Oh boy, you don't know me. You see, I came down to ask you to help me to take my, to take water so that, give me water so I can take green tea. And you know, your job here is to make sure that your customers, your guests, you know, feel well. And if for any reason any of your customers are not feeling happy, and they have to report to top management, that would be too bad. You are a young man. Don't do that. Your job is to find solutions, not to create problems. I need this water because I need to take it. This is not your last bus stop. You've just started life. Don't you think that some of us must have done the job we did before we got to this level?" So you see the angle I was coming from. The boy started coming down. Started coming down. Even though I know that what he did was wrong. Because front desk people are the first contact people between an organization and outsiders.
That's correct.
So if you put somebody who is hot blooded, thank you, madam. I agree with all your analysis. Because I do some research on bloodline. So I understood quite a lot of the things she was talking about. You know, if you put somebody who is hot-blooded there, any little thing, he gets angry. Any little thing is angry, you will spoil your business, two of us. If you put somebody who is cool-blooded, somebody who is calm, who knows how to solve problems and all that, even if it's a client or somebody who didn't want to buy, he can take because of that person and still do business with them. That's why when you recruit, when you do business with people, you must know the personality type of those you are dealing with. At the age, as teenagers, at the working age, people have already developed their personality. Aristotle said that as we grow up, we don't change, we become more of who we are. People don't change. They become more of who they are. It took me time to understand it. Don't try to change people. If they want to change, they will only change certain things they do. But to change who they are, la la, they will become more of who they are.
Interesting.
That somebody was a thief, a known criminal, and he now said he has repented, and he's the treasurer of the church. Let me tell you, one day he will steal the money of the church. He will steal it. Because like Olamide Soyinka says, you are not a thief because you stole. You stole because you are a thief. It's a very deep one. You are not a thief because you stole. You stole because you are a thief. It's in the blood. There are certain things we do because it's in your blood. Science calls it DNA. That's what science calls it. It's there in the bloodline. It's intergenerational. When they see it manifesting, those who know your generation, your people, they say, we know them. We know them. You will think that they don't know what they are saying. They know. Let's go. Cracks, you know, the walls that have cracks. That's what conflict does. When you see a, you know, a back cross, you know, a white spot, like a white place like this, white wall like this, and there's a dark spot here, where which part of the wall attracts more attention?
That black spot.
You can imagine 99.9% of that space is white. But just one dark spot. Somebody enters this place. As he's looking up, oh, there's a stain here. There's a stain. Why is it that even though 99.9% of the space is still okay, just one spot has that dent is attracting attention. That's what conflict does. When you see a wall that has cracks, something is wrong. When you see a business relationship that has cracks, something is wrong. There are people I cannot do business with. You don't need to do business with everybody. It's not everybody you can do business with. Everybody will not be your customer. Don't struggle. Those who will come to you will come to you. It is not by prayer or fasting. It is by your capacity to sell the product which the Holy Spirit has asked you and prepared you to sell. When you are doing it, you are doing it effortlessly. Because already it's your grace. It's part of you. What the Holy Spirit reveals to you, it doesn't reveal to another person. That's how the Holy Spirit works. I've had cause to tell you people last year that the numerous inventions we all have in our world today are the grace of the Holy Spirit. There was a time in our history we never had a microphone to amplify our voices. But somebody received that grace, two of us. In fact, there was a time that we didn't have all the plans. The Wright brothers, about 110 or 15 years ago, received that grace. They were not university professors. They were not physicists. They were just mechanics. But look at the grace that God gave them. And they were able to incubate that idea to fly an object in the air. What grace is greater than that? Before then, we already had professors. Professors of physics. But there were no professors of aeronautical engineering. It was from their work, from their invention, that people now became professors of aeronautical engineering. They now had to study them. They studied those who didn't go to university. Because they had the grace of the Holy Spirit. Because what God reveals to you in the dream, in your own private moments, are the things that you will use to survive in this complex universe. The world is very complex. So complex that complex things appear very simple and simple things appear very complex. If you don't understand how to walk through that maze, you will think that you have come here to waste your time. Some of you and some of us understand how to survive and grow in this universe. Don't worry. Do what you have to do. And when it is time to reap the fruits of your labor, the customers will come. You are not the one that sends them. You are not the one. They come on their own. That's it. Next. That's my word. What causes conflict? So we want to rationalize conflict. Conflict is an opportunity to learn, true or false?
True.
Good. The need to survive and grow is the greatest need of humans. Then, reaction or response is usually seen as an abnormal behavior. Though when you say something or you take you want to do something within a space or a business environment, and the other person is responding in a way you don't like, you know, you will think that the person is doing, is behaving abnormally, true or false. But you do not understand that the person is not you. The experiences you have, the person don't like. The information at your disposal is not at his disposal of the other person. His needs are different, our needs are different, our values are different, our interests are different. And so you must understand this and factor them into that relationship. But I caused to teach somewhere last year. And I asked, who is the customer of baby napkins? The baby or the parents?
The parents.
Do you understand my question?
The parents.
Who is the customer of baby napkins?
The parents.
Who is the customer of baby food?
The parents.
The parents or the baby?
The parents. The parents. Who buys the food?
Who feels strongly about the parents?
I do.
Tell us. Don't worry. We'll resolve this now.
Not the beneficiary, the customer. Who buys it?
Maybe at that infancy, cannot know or doesn't know how to even use money. The baby can even lay out some money. It's the parents that goes against the material for the baby.
Who feels that? You are saying that it's the parents, but who feels that it's the baby that's the customer?
I feel. She feels.
That's the woman's voice. Who is saying the baby?
It's me.
Who says the baby? Okay.
A man has spoken. No, we are in a general world.
Without the baby, the food will not be sold.
Yeah. So the baby is the customer?
Yes, they are, you know, they are 99% of white food is being produced.
Let's leave it at that. We're not being resolving now. Because I was teaching business model innovation sometime last year to female entrepreneurs. I posed this question. There was a disagreement like this. You know. But the truth is this, the customer of baby products are the parents, not the babies. When you do advertising,
who can they be?
When you do publicity, whose attention do you target?
The parents.
The parents. The parents. Who has the money?
The parents.
The capacity to purchase.
Who has capacity to purchase?
The parents.
Great. So in business, modeling or business model, that's one thing you need to understand. Maybe we will have opportunity, you know, I'll tell the president here to give us opportunity to discuss what business model is. Because many business people go into business without understanding the concept of business model. What they will teach you, they will ask you, what business are you in? Say, I sell clothes, I do this. But some people are smart enough to tell you, I am in the beauty business. Some people will not tell you they sell cream. Okay? Some people will not tell you they sell clothes. They will tell you they are in the beauty business. You need to understand business model, your business model. Because it is only through that that you understand how revenue can come to your business. Business model is a design. It's a revenue generation design. In that process, at that stage, you understand who will pay for your products or services. It's at that stage of business model where you're designing the business. Do you know that five persons can be selling the same products, but they have five different business models? True or false?
True.
I can give you, this is a digression, but it's useful. You are all selling minerals. Some sell mineral in the morning, true of us. Some sell it on the streets. Some sell it in the shop. Some sell it in the night. Okay? Some only supply to events. Different business model, the same products. So if you don't understand your model, knowing what to do, how, where to get money for your business, you will just think that when you have a fine shop and a fine space, you put fine shelves and you do fine advertising, you don't know who you will target. No money comes. And then you think that if you spend 10 hours doing fasting and prayer, that's what will solve it. And I usually tell you, what if God answers your prayer and you're not ready? What if God answers your prayer and you're not ready? What happens? Somebody who is ready will take it, whether he is a Christian or not. That's why those who are not even Christians are doing well. That's good. Now, psychology, biology, physics. In psychology, we talk about aggression. In biology, we talk about antagonisms of the species. You know that the species always quarrel, I hope you know.
Yeah, yes.
There's heavy quarrel, constant quarrels, even among us human beings. That's serious. You know, the differences are so much that we don't even know how to manage them. You're doing business with somebody from the beginning. I said here, be careful. That present victory does not present, does not give you the seeds of future problems. You are doing a business with somebody. You didn't settle the percentage. I read the person that how much it will take, so I cannot worry. We belong to the same church. Are we not from the same community? Let me sign it first. You have sold the item. You now know that you deserve a big profit. And the man now gives you something that you don't deserve. And you say, oh God, now trouble, you define it. You are looking for trouble, though. But at the beginning, you forgot that the man told you, how much will you take? So it tells us that at the beginning, try and settle some terms. Try and agree. So that the victory at the beginning will not produce seeds of conflict at the end. Physics. Reaction or response, usually seen, I said so. Now, alignment and disalignment of forces. For those of you who are good in physics, you should understand what we call centrifugal forces and centripetal forces. This is big a little, except those who are inside it, inside physics. Centrifugal forces are forces that are pulling things apart. And centripetal forces are forces that are, those are magnetic things. They are things that bring them together. And countervailing forces are forces that are so heavy that they can neutralize the two forces. Let me give a very funny example of what happened in the States. You know that during the political conflict here, there were centrifugal forces and there were centripetal forces. True of us?
True.
But you also know that for the thing to be resolved, there were countervailing forces. Those countervailing forces were heavier and weightier than the two other forces. And so, when the countervailing forces came, when Aine came, you know, even the soldiers said, don't be weird, don't be wasting people. There are people, somebody who said, I'm winning the 15 between local government say they should cancel the election. You know, I don't want to produce any sentiment, but these are what happened before, three of us. So when that conflict took place, forces were at play. We understood it. We knew it would be resolved by the countervailing forces. Haven't you found out in a business that when you are disagreeing with your customer, somebody, maybe the chairman of your association, can just be walking around by any means of, an accident comes through there, hey Chukwudi, what is happening? Say, look at this customer. This is what he bought, doesn't want to pay, and this and that, we agree this, and it's okay, don't worry. What's the problem? The rabbi says, okay, don't worry, let's go and settle it in our office. And you who refuse to agree, because your chairman showed up, you are now camp. True of us. That chairman has become a countervailing force. I hope we are going somewhere.
Yes, sir.
Next. What causes conflict in business? Let me start with what is not here. Disagreement, quarrels arising from consumers. As for instance, if consumers use your product or they buy your product and they are dissatisfied, it can cause conflict, true of us. If the service you even render is not consummate or is not up to what they paid for, there will be conflict, true of us. Good. Conflict of interest. Many people don't understand conflict of interest. We discuss it usually during when we are studying board governance. That's ethics in organizations. Board governance. There are people who are in some associations, public associations, not your, even your private business. It happens too that they do not draw a line between them and their business. It doesn't matter if it is your business. If your son visits your office and now wants to take something, or use any facility, especially maybe any product you're selling, he or she needs to go through some, he needs to go through some protocols, two of us. Otherwise, not that because he is your son, he goes, grabs a bottle of Coke and starts drinking the thing. Who will pay for it? He didn't tell you, he just came into his father's shop and goes to, and another person is walking there. And just go grab a bottle of Coke and start drinking. You will pay for it though. But if the child goes to the mother or the father or tells the person in charge, please tell mommy I want to take Coke. Has he not gone through a procedure? That's a procedure. And then mother comes, give the boy a Coke, a bottle of Coke. But if at every point you do not draw a line between your interest, personal interest, and the interest of the organization, there will be conflict of interest. You do certain things, and the only people who are qualified are your brothers and sisters. Other people are not qualified. It's happening in many places, public organizations, and all that. Owando PMC has been sanctioned now. I hope some of you have read it. Owando PMC, I've been reading that as a business case study since last year. They've been cooking their books. Nairametrics, an online publication, business publication, has done a deep analysis of how Owando has been cooking his books. But Volpi, one of the directors, a white man, took them to the cleaners. But they were also trying to outsmart the man. And so the man took them to Security and Exchange Commission. And then they did what they call forensic audits of their books. And they failed. they are brought to government rules, principles. So they've sanctioned them, they've told them to resign all the board members. In fact, some of them will not hold any position in any public company for 5 years. Owendo, breach of agreement. You know, this is very rampant in business, two of us. You have an agreement with somebody. Agreements are oral or written. Agreements are oral or written. So don't say that it must be documented before it's an agreement. Okay? So people breach agreements. In fact, where you experience this more is a partnership agreement. I've had cause to pull out of a partnership. Partnership of intelligent people who didn't demonstrate intelligence. You know when intelligent people meet, there's usually so much conflict. I hope you know that. That's why Nigeria is the way we are. And the person who you think is not intelligent is the one who leads you. But I always tell people, I say, look, I won't mention his name, this is a presentation. I always tell people, I say, in their culture, politics is in their blood. Have you interacted with an average fool anymore on the streets of Port Harcourt? He is deeply, he knows what he's doing. He's so aware, so conscious. He may not read and write. But he's fully conscious of himself and what he's doing. How many of our people do it here? How many? At least that some of our youths will go to join the dark consciousness, dark awareness, they don't join cults. And they think that that's where they put their own energy, dark energy. So we met, formed a partnership for business, defined our object, registered it. And I was the ideas man in that team. I was the one that writes the proposals. I write proposals. It's given to me as a grace. I'm the thinker in the team. And we had an administrator. The guy is good in managing men and materials. And we gave it to him. And this guy can manage every one of us. Then there's one other person who is good in giving money. I would say, you will be our treasurer. And there's another one who is good in networking. And we said, you will be in charge of, you know, communications and relationship. When money started coming in, when money started coming in, because we did not do what we call partnership agreements. In the beginning, I told them, I said, look, we can't rush to do business. Would that be a partnership agreement? Let's define who does what. Let's know our powers, our limitations, how conflicts will be resolved. They say, but we've been friends for over 10 years. That is where we misbehaved. And when money started coming in millions, we couldn't manage our brilliance. And my late wife was still there that time. She saw how trouble that was. I said, but you know what normally happens when you do business. She read political science, so she was very good in dictating human behavior. You know what happens when people don't lay down, when they don't agree how profit will be shared, how resources will be managed. There are people who know how to share money. They don't know how to bring money. I hope you know that.
Yes,
you will be seeing this in your businesses. You will be seeing that. You see, Madame came here, I was talking, trying to persuade us to understand the thing and all that. Her business model is very sound. If I sit down with her now and begin to tell her to develop this business model and market it more, she will see some lights. Because that's a unique business model. Very unique. Even the doctors will not beat her to it. That's the truth. And to stand before people and try to convince them to change their pattern of behavior. To change their pattern of behavior. Not to eat what they love to eat for years and change and even have new insights into their nutrition. It's a very difficult job.
Yeah, it is.
And that's what she was doing here this morning. Having done that, as some people were signing, revenue starts coming. And that's when the accountant in the office will tell you, madam, there's no money. There's no money. And then she said, how did the money even come? Nobody didn't bring the money. It happens. So you need to understand that something at that point, I woke up and I called all of them. I said, we need to dissolve this partnership. They said, why? Can't we resolve it? I said, there's no partnership agreement. So we don't even have a basis for resolution. But if there's a partnership agreement, there will be what we call conflict resolution clause. Rather mediation or arbitration. So they all agreed. There was money in the bank. We met. I was very calm and I addressed them. I said, let's keep our friendship. Let's not do business as friends. Though the two things are clashing. So let's the money we have in the bank, let us bring it. How much we have, the treasurer told us, let's share it. Take your own. They said, we've not finished one project. So let's keep 1 million for that project. I said, okay. We'll share the rest. The man, that same treasurer, that project we didn't do, we couldn't do it, the guy chopped the money. So we dissolved that partnership. It didn't work. We have a program in our institute that deals with partnership development and management. It's a full 3-4 days program. I believe that when we advertise it, you know, you will say, it's not, you don't go into a business with everybody. It's not everybody. You form an association and you bring in people as directors. You don't know who they are, you don't know their value system. And then at the point of opening an account, because a public organization, set rules tells you that you can't be the only signatory. You have to sign with somebody else. If it's your business and you have the majority share, you can be sole signatory. If you even want to accommodate them, it's your business. You know, you can say A, B, B. That means that, or A and B. That means that number A must be constant. That's a way of checkmating. But when the money starts coming in, that dormant director, that dormant partner, will be the one who sees you now, your lifestyle has started changing. He says, that's our company. You have not called meeting for 6 months, so. That's our company. You have not called meeting for 6 months. What is going on? Eh? Then you now start to explain yourself. You know? At that point, you can say, well, if I'm not seeing anything in this thing, who can remove my name from that place? Because I'm not seeing anything. Conflicts begin to come out. So that's what happened, breach of agreement. People write contract agreement, people write agreements, and people even have verbal agreements and they breach those agreements. Conflict will come in. But the capacity, the trust of this presentation is the capacity to develop, the idea that you develop the capacity to manage a conflict. Conflict will occur, but have the capacity to manage the conflict. That's what we are saying. It will occur, but how do you resolve it? Breakdown of communication, we discussed that. Fake products, you know there are so many fake products in the market. They are there. They can cause conflict in business. People see it on social media. You know where you go. In fact, watch out. If you are always going to a supermarket to buy something, periodically, because for those of us who teach innovation, if you look at the date of expiration, it's usually between April, March, April. Most products don't expire middle of the year. It's always March, April, or either January, March, April, or September, October, November. The middle of the year, most products don't expire. They are very conscious to enable the product not to expire middle of the year, because that's the time, you know, business is at this peak. So, but if you are always going to supermarkets to buy something, and it's that time of the year, always check the products. Check the products. Because some of these products are expiring. They're expiring. So you don't buy poison and take. Clash of ego. You know, this is very, very easy. Clash of ego. You know, I won't take this from you with all kinds of violent words. I won't take this from you. This and that and that. This and that is an ego thing and it leads to conflict. Clash of values and needs. Clash of values and needs. Dominance. Somebody is saying that I am the CEO and you are this. And then the other person is saying, Oga, I know I am this, but pay me my salary. Make I go. You know? And that little level, I've experienced it. You know? We didn't pay for 1 month. The second month, things were rough. I kept on appealing to them that we were trying to resolve a business issue. They should bear with us. But we were able to, you know, be up and being with our weekly transport allowances. I feel to them, the security guard now said, Oga, this car will be driving. When you go to the filling station, do you tell them that you don't have money? Do you usually tell them you don't have money? This car you drive it every day for the past 2 months, you've been coming to work and all that. But why is it difficult to pay this much more salary? When you try to see it as an insult, without knowing what he's trying to communicate, there will be a bigger problem. Two of us. So the boy bolted and said, I know they walk again, no, never have any. My salary. So he didn't stop there, he went to a police station. And then Nigerian police, they will harass you. The guy called my number and I explained. I was very calm and said, well, yes, we're owing you. It's true, we're owing you. But I promise that by next week, even if we don't pay the 2 months, we're going to start paying the last month so that we can resolve. After all, he has left. So we will settle it. The man said, oh, we have answered very gently. Because somehow they were also thinking that, you know, I will answer in a very angry way. You know, I said, no, we are only here. We work with us. The boy is a very good person and all that. Unfortunately, things are very tough with us. But since you are left, we will try and look for money and pay. You know, that was how we resolved it. And we were able to look for money and pay. When those conflicts occur, because they will, we try and resolve them. Okay? Unfair and unethical business practices. Let me put a naughty example here. The unfair ones, you people know, treating people on equals and as unequals. You know, in your business relationships. Don't do that. Any person who is doing business with you, who deserves to get something big, let the person get something big. Okay? But the example I need to give is this. If you are in an association, or if you are doing business, and you are being seduced, I'm not saying this because of women, I'm saying it for both sexes. You are doing it because of unethical reason. When the bubble bursts, it will be very difficult for you to handle. You're always going to a particular shop to buy something because of a girl. Or a girl is always going going to a particular shop to buy something because of a man. You know, it happens. What is driving you is not the product you are buying. It is the person you want to see. And if she tells you no, any little mistake around there, you say, this is a useless organization. Is that how you people treat customers? You know, all kinds of tempers will rise. Misplaced aggression. You know,
misplaced
and all that. And then the manager or whoever will come, oh, you got this, what is the problem? He's like, you can't even see this guy. Can you imagine? I've been calling here for all your best customers. Look, I want it.
Oh my God.
You know? So now, and the manager we are thinking, oh yeah, come, follow me too. Let's go. So, but those who know will know that it is not the product of the something else is causing it. You know, sometimes the co-workers will go, what did you do to this man? He said, no man, the man, a foolish man. He said, I'm speaking out. You know, so, and like I said, it's not only the media to women. There are some women who also chase men. I hope you know that.
Yes,
like a young man, or you like a man. And it's for that reason you are always going there. You know? Don't think that if you want to use that to influence the person, that you get the better bargain. You will enjoy yourself at the end of the day.
Yeah.
I teach negotiation and I do negotiations. And I tell people, when you are at the negotiation table, a lot of things take place. I've negotiated with a multinational oil company, Total. I was the chief negotiator several times. And in one of the negotiations, they brought their deputy managing director to negotiate with an expert negotiator as well. And at their team, they put some brilliant people. You know, the oil companies have brilliant people who are trained at all levels, here and abroad. And then they brought some fine ladies across the other side. You know? And in one of these negotiations, one of the ladies dressed in miniskirts. And I didn't know it was the leader of our delegation that they were targeting. Because normally before we take a decision, he's the one who will say, let us agree. I was staying close to him. I was negotiating. But before we make final concession on any issue, or we make an offer, who will agree? If he says, okay, let us leave it there. And by a kind of oratory or whatever, I didn't know that they had studied him. They knew that he was a womanizer. And they set that lady there. Only to be, when the tough issues are on the board, that's when the lady will start talking. With a fine voice. Hello. This is a real. I hope you know. They're very real. They're very real. In fact, my pastor will always tell me that you are first of all a human being before you're a Christian. That's the truth. So any pastor who says he has not been tempted is not telling the truth. Yeah. And the wife was there when he was saying. So we didn't know when we had a break. This lady had cornered this guy because the issue was so contentious. We didn't agree. They made an offer, we flinched. We said, no way. Voices were rising, and I was calm. You know? He now suggested, let us take a break. You know, tea break, so that tempers can calm down. At the time we took a break, that lady cornered him the wall. I was not talking to him. You know? So I was busy where I was taking my tea. Hello? And as soon as I came back, he now said, wait first. This thing, let's not agree too much. So, instead of the animal to run away, I said, why? This is the information at our disposal. This is wait. We have other things we're discussing. This thing, we have other things to gain. So I didn't know that I sacked him up. The lady had cornered him, had started telling him all sorts of things and all that. Look at a beautiful lady. She's now the legal manager of the town. Beautiful, brilliant lady. At that time, she was young. I was always following them to their teams, working, you know, very well. Today, she's a manager. Very big manager now, you know. So it happens. It will be women that are negotiating. And you are seeing a young man out there and so handsome and brilliant. His brilliance and his handsomeness carries you away. And whatever your associates, even maybe your lawyer is telling you, madam, don't agree to this, say, don't worry, we'll take care of it. they won't know that you are responding to the brilliance and the attraction, or what I call distraction from the other side. Be very careful. Very, very careful. When you are in a business negotiation, don't allow your emotions to rule you. Next. Stages of conflict. Formation stage, tension, I'm very fast here now. Tension. When a conflict is about to happen, the energy flow between the parties will begin to change. You will notice tension. Then, there are broken promises. Broken promises. Broken promises. You said you are going to pay by evening before 4 p.m. The payment has not come. This is 5 minutes to 4. What's going on? Oga, cool down now. 4 never reach. Is it 4? After 4 o'clock, the payment is enter. You call back again. They said there were network issues. We are trying to transfer. We couldn't transfer. Broken promises. And so it is that. The following day, no payment. The third day, excuses. Business relationship. Disharmony. Lack of trust. Perception change. The way you see it is not the way I'm seeing it. Oh, I thought you meant this. No, that's not what we agreed. Then indirect actions. You people agree to do something. The person is doing it from the other side, from the other point. When you go for this sales presentation, this is what you will tell them, oh, all of you agreed as a team. The person goes there, the atmosphere is different. Maybe sees the church members and all that, decides to do something else. Or he sees somebody from his community, he decides to take an action that is indirect and at the end messes up the presentation. So all those things happen. Conflict occurs, they start to blame each other. Escalation stage, from formation, escalates anger. The person demonstrates open anger. Or even concealed anger. It's boiling. He's not talking, but it's boiling. You know, we call that body language. The person is angry. My first degree was in theater arts, so I understood that very well before I moved into sociology. Okay? And then I worked as a journalist for a very long time. So I understand very well how human beings react. There are times people will communicate with you without talking. You know, this fact, they are strong here. They're not talking, but they are strong. Then threats. Once it builds up from that anger, disagreement, threats. You know that things are moving very fast. As of now, not actually dismiss those threats. Positions adding. People take position. I will never
accept this. It will never happen. Over my dead body. People start making statements like that. In a negotiation training, I had said, never say over your dead, my dead body. For what belongs to you, let the other person die for it.
Yes.
Don't you ever make that statement over my dead body. They will kill you.
Yes, sir.
That thing that belongs to you, you say over my dead body. You go die. Wrong statement. All those who said so during Lankis, they kill them.
Yes, sir.
Communication breaks down. Crucial confrontations. Crucial confrontations. You see people not confronting themselves, they are fighting. Crisis stage, direct action. Indirect action. He has gone to the back to do something else. You know? Sometimes if it is between a landlord and a tenant, the cops takes a law and locks the door. Eh? He has, you have gone out to, he watches that you have gone out. He comes back and locks the door. When you come, it's another problem that is there. You know, the thing has built to a very high stage. True of us. Some will bring talks. They come and start, they will break the place, start throwing your listing out. Violence, casualties. Next. De-escalation stage. At that point of escalation, when the conflict has gone to that stage, in a business relationship or in a normal relationship, try for you to de-escalate that conflict by the kind of words you make, by the kind of steps you take, by the kind of body language you give. You reopen communication. Third party intervention. That means that you're not able to ask the people, the landlord's brother, or the brother to the other partner, or to the other person, or the referee to that staff who is quarreling you. You know when people submit, they have referees. You call the person. This is what is happening. The person that you guarantee, or the referee, please call him to order. I've done that several times. Then can we meet and resolve this thing? The person will call him. What's happening in your workplace? This is. Okay, don't mind those foolish people. That's how they start. Don't mind those foolish people. The person will say, calm down. What really happened? Now, willingness to negotiate and then compromises. That is de-escalation. Now we move to improvement stage. Improvement says ceasefire. That means all those positions you have taken. If the landlord locked on the day, it's okay. You don't open the door now. At least step and all calm down. Don't be so? If the shop that was locked before, they don't go open up. You know? If the man said that because he didn't pay for the goods, we are coming. You know, a lot of things are now. You know? Then negotiations, mediation, arbitration. People are now trying to settle the thing, bringing third parties or bringing somebody who can settle you people. Then settlement terms and options. How are you going to pay the money? I don't have this money to pay in 1 month, I'll pay in 3 months. In 3 months is how it will be paid. You know? And then agreement. Transformation stage. Many people don't understand. This is why we say conflict is an opportunity for growth. There are certain conflicts that you will experience in your relationship with people, and that makes you not to quarrel deeply again. Because of that conflict in your relationship, present and in the future, you would like to avoid what happened before. Never again. This thing has led me to understand you better, your likes and dislikes, the things I shouldn't do. We witness that in our personal relationships, even our business relationship. So conflict transformation is that level where you use conflict to strengthen relationships. You use conflict to build in some kind of harmony that exists, that makes the relationship
to now move to the next level. That's what we call conflict transformation. In Rwanda, you know that there was a politically motivated ethnic conflict in Rwanda. Today, nobody mentions ethnicity in Rwanda, true or false. They are doing so well now that they are the top greenest city. Kigali is their capital. Yeah. Kigali is the top greenest city. Is it in the world or in Africa?
Africa.
I think in Africa, you know. So, where are you from? It's not there in their lexicon again, in their dialogue, in their conversations. It's not there. In Nigeria, it's still there. People, Hausa, Yoruba, Kalabari, Kukule, Oba, Urubo. We are still into these ethnic cleavages that make us not to see the bigger picture. In Rwanda, because of that conflict, that ethnic conflict, they have transformed their relationships. They have moved to that next level where societies operate to know that your differences, your diversity, your diversities are the beauty that God gave you. When you know what I can do and I know what you can do, we can go very far. That's what's happening in Rwanda now. Here, we've not gotten to that level. Then, of course, improved relationship implementation of agreement. Next slide. Conflict resolution strategies. Now we are winding down. And I would like to read this. And this is one thing that touched my heart, my practice as a conflict resolution professional, a practitioner. It is easy for people to smile with you, cooperate with you, wine and dine with you when the going is easy. True or false?
True.
The true test of every relationship is conflict. The true test of leadership and business competence is the capacity to manage conflicts. When conflict has not occurred in a relationship, when the whole thing is not moving smooth, be very, very careful. Is that the person hiding something that he will do in the future? You know, I do it very well. There should be conflict of views, and then you resolve. There should even be, you know, minor disagreements, and you resolve. There should be some bargaining that takes place, and you close the gaps, you know? But that is the true test of business relationship. You were not able to pay the money today. But 3 days after, you paid the money. The person will not say, you didn't pay the money. True or false? The agreement says you paid the money in 48 hours. But you didn't pay in 48 hours, you paid in 56 hours. But you still paid the money. That is not enough for you to discard the relationship. Next. This is a big man of God. You know, marketplace apostles places a lot of emphasis on spiritual things. And this for me is very deep. Apostle Suleiman said, Johnson, Apostle Suleiman Johnson, Johnson Suleiman said, the things that are conscious, that you are conscious of in battle, are the things you triumph over. Don't be psychedelic. The powers that are fighting you are not gentle. Do we understand this?
Yes, sir.
The things that you are conscious of in battle are the things that you triumph over. If you are not conscious that this thing, this attitude, this behavior, whatever, this kind of thing can lead to a problem, if we continue like this without resolving it, you won't triumph over those things. If all the signs of conflict are there and you sweep them under the carpet, by the time the conflict explodes, it will be too much. Again, let me return to political conflict. Sorry if you're a member of ABC. At least I have apologized. You know, what happened in River State was that the argument of some of the parties was that allow everybody to contest, two of us. Allow everybody to contest. Whoever wins becomes the party flag bearer. Then some groups say, no, this our organ leads we follow. It is that our organ leads we follow that cause not only problem for that one position, even the small position, they lost it. Two of us. So he had his way by still nominating the person he wanted. He lost at the end. And I tested my principle, which I said at the beginning. Be careful that present victory does not contain the seeds of future defeat or problems. Are you seeing it now? He had his way, but the forces that were also fighting him made sure that not even one person contested the election. You move over to Zamfara State, they even went to the ballot. INEC also declared them. The Supreme Court still said you didn't follow INEC guidelines. They had their will, INEC declared them. The other party went to the Supreme Court. But you see, when we talk about conflict resolution, it's not just in business. Even in political families, people can bring people together, resolve the conflict between parties, among brothers, among party members. These things can be resolved before it gets to that stage. If you look at those stages of conflict, before the thing gets to that level, it can be handled. And interests, needs can be addressed. But when you sweep it under the carpet and you obtain present victory, don't forget that that present victory will contain the seeds of future problems. I just use that because that, for me, you know, makes a very obvious example. Now, Peter Drucker, most of you have read his books. If you have not read the books of Peter Drucker, go look for his books. Peter F. Drucker was the greatest management thinker of the 20th century. They called him the father of modern management. Much of the management theories or business theories were developed by Peter Drucker. Read his books, you gain insights into how business relations operate. And this is what Peter Drucker said. He said that there is nothing so painful as to do so perfectly what should not be done at all. There is nothing so painful as to do so perfectly what should not be done at all. Do we understand this?
Yeah.
That's very deep.
Very deep.
That thing ties up to my principle, to my words. You do something, so what you shouldn't do. You know, I told you here that it's not about what you want to do. It's about what you should not do. Knowing what you should not do. There are, as at my level, there are things I have done in life that I have regretted. I ask myself, oh, wisdom, you don't try for this one. This one, you don't try. When I'm doing self-evaluation, I tell myself like that. This one, you don't try. You don't try. Then it becomes a guidepost for me. When I encounter similar situation, I now know I'm not supposed to repeat that mistake. I check myself. If you don't do that kind of self-evaluation, you'll be stumbling over the same tree many times. And you won't know when that tree, a fall, will consume you. Okay? He says, don't be psychedelic. The women, you know what psychedelic means. You people wear shoes that are very, you know, and then you move in an unnatural way. that somebody doesn't know, somebody who is not taught becomes taught. No, so they say it's what do they call that style? Cat walk. Cat walk. Do not walk like a cat, not like a human being. You know? So that's being psychedelic. You're not being natural. When you're not being natural, when you are not putting your cards on the table in a business relationship. We are from the same community now. Not in the same church we dey go. We are from the same senatorial zone. Are we not all Igbos? Are we not all Igbole? Are we not Calabari? Are we not Yorubas? When you begin to define relationships based on that, you are being psychedelic. You are not facing reality.
Yes, sir.
You are not. Because the things, the forces that are fighting you are not gentle. When they start, when the person becomes angry, he will overreact, or she will overreact. You can imagine social media a few weeks ago, you see somebody cutting off somebody's head. You know, even among the courts, intercourse rivalry, what do? They kill and cut off. You can imagine that level of aggression. Eh? Maybe it's just a conflict between one or two persons over resources, over who will control the market, security in the market. Check very well, we've done studies about cultism and conflict in university. Most of these things are tied to economic resources. You know, if you check my list, I said assets and resources, you saw it. When they are struggling for the control of those markets, or those assets and resources, cult groups are involved, youth groups are involved. Then they begin to trade, you know, power to the point where they forget that they are first of all brothers and sisters or brothers from the same community. When it gets to a very high level, they keep the cut off. Very sad. When these forces come up, they are not gentle forces. The forces of conflict are not gentle.
Yeah.
The forces of war are not gentle. Mm-hmm. People go to the extremes to demonstrate the depth of their anger and emotions. So don't be psychedelic. Next. The four windows of conflict opportunity. The four windows of conflict opportunity. The first window is win lose. You are doing a business. You won, you lost. You're very happy, it's not happy. The second window is lose win. You lost, he won. You are not happy, he's very happy. Okay? These are windows. The third window is lose lose. Both of you were into a business relationship and it didn't work now. You know? Both of you lost. You were trying to, egos, you know, you were trying to do it your own way. He was trying to do it his own way. At the end, there was no profit. You people lost. If only you settle down to do marketing, or you know that the other person is better, has better understanding of the market, and you ought to listen to his ideas more, and then allow him space to implement. You say, no, now you be okay now. So you start to micromanage. We gave you 5,000 for this system. You didn't return your any change. You start to probe how the money that you will gain for transport. So you use 5,000 naira for one day activity. And yet you told the person to roll out the whole of Port Harcourt. You start to micromanage. Micromanaging leads to conflicts. We know what micromanaging is.
Yes.
Do we understand? Micromanaging is when you are over, you know, supervising, always getting involved too much in every part of the business activity or any organizational activity. You said somebody is the social media coordinator. Allow the person to do the social media and report back to you. When you now see something wrong, you draw the person's attention. When you see something right, you also draw, oh, this is very powerful. I like this. Like, but can you change this thing like this? Can you make it more like this? You know? That he or she is the social media coordinator, but you have to say, come. Before you send it, Make sure I'm down. You know? Maybe the person is the creative type that likes to do it during his or her own time. Maybe during break time. That time is driven away. When he or she has taken a bottle of coke, that's when he's more rich, she's more relaxed to do social media. Or she also understands social media time belts and knows the time to release the material. When people are more relaxed, when people are come back from work, maybe any evening after they want to check their social media before they sleep, and the person understands timing. And yet, you say, no, this thing must be released this afternoon. And she tells you that, okay, not be this afternoon we will release it. I will release it in the evening, any evening. You say, no, release it now. You are micromanaging. He or she understands that market. You don't understand it. Otherwise, we wouldn't have appointed him there. Are we together?
Yes, sir.
Great. Now, the fourth window is win-win. We have a bargain, came to buy something, we're doing the business together, and we feel satisfied with the outcome of this business. And we are ready to do business again. Now, this is what one management consultant in the US will always ask those who came to do business with them. He said, would you recommend us to another customer? He said, after every transaction, always ask your clients, would you recommend us to another customer? If they say yes, you know you have succeeded. If they say, I'll think about it, you know that there's a problem. True or false?
True.
If they are not telling you, rest right there. I say, yes, your services are good. I'll bring in people, you know. You are cooking food, you're running a restaurant, and people are complaining not about your food, but about your service. There are two things. The food can be good, but if the service is poor, there is a gap. True or false?
Yes.
If the environment does not meet the content of the plate, there's a gap. These things also lead to conflict. The person pays for the food is good, but the environment is not good. Or the person serving the food is not serving it in a nice way. That is the hospitality industry. Or they go, please give me toothpick. No answer. Please give me toothpick. No answer. It is a crime that the customer who goes to a restaurant to eat is always requesting for something. After toothpick, they will give me serviette. After serviette, give me salt. After, give me small pepper. Bring this. You know? Most of you must have experienced this. It does not tell well of the owners or the managers of that business. Bring water. Or will you drink water? You serve somebody food and you are asking. You go drink water. you know. For somebody like you, ask me whether I will drink water. I will ask you, is it part of the bill? You know. So, minor things. But take care of them from the beginning, so that the person does not finish eating and says, "Thank you. Now bye bye." When we want to see me here, I go. But I'm not asking me here again, and I'm going to insult me. Don't be so. It just leaves. Let's open the windows. Conflict resolution strategies, action steps. Step one, identify the conflict. Identify the conflict. Step two, decide whether to intervene. Decide whether that relationship is worth the effort of mending it or even having that relationship. Let me reveal something to you today. Agreeing to disagree is also a method of conflict resolution. Agreeing to disagree. It's also a method of conflict resolution. That guy is a difficult customer.
told you, yeah, it's not everybody you have to do business with. Each time he buys, there's always a quarrel. So he has bought this one. He don't raise trouble. Okay, what do we do with this person? Don't worry, let him go. Simple. Let's call him now, talk to him. He said, don't worry. You have agreed to disagree. Let him go. So at this stage, you will decide whether to intervene to mend that relationship. That's why some relationships are broken down irretrievably. Some relationships
between the boy and the girl, between the husband and the woman, have broken down irretrievably. Nobody can intervene. Because at that point, the person, no. In fact, don't forget that some people are also waiting for conflict to occur. I hope you know that. So that they can walk away. They will use that as an excuse to just come. Step three, identify the party's issues and emotions. Identify those who are involved in the conflict. Even if it's one person, this thing does not involve our in-laws first. Let me deal with her. Let's be resolved with him. You don't need to get other people involved yet. Identify those who may be affected by the conflict and try to manage that within them. Analyze the conflict. You must do conflict analysis. Because if you don't do conflict analysis, you won't be able to understand the nature of the conflict and the appropriate mechanism to use or approach to resolve the conflict. Design the conflict resolution process. So you will know this one, before this person will listen, let's use a third party, a mediator, or let's use an arbitrator, let's use an elder who will talk to us, and both of us will listen. You know we do it, not we so? We always do it. You know both of you cannot sit down and resolve. You say, if we have been sitting down, each time there's a problem, both of us will sit down. Yeah, the problem will occur each time. This time around, let another person come and resolve it. Then, educate parties and get agreement to participate. So, you call up the person to say, look, we shouldn't continue like this. Let's resolve these things. These things happen. This is unnatural. They are normal. Let's try to resolve this and move on. We've done business for a very long time. It's not this thing that should break us and pull friends apart. Okay? And the person begins to see reason why he or she needs to participate in the conflict resolution process. Conduct conflict resolution meetings via appropriate ADR mechanisms. ADR means alternative dispute resolution. So it must be appropriate. There's a slide that talks about it, so I'm always standing here. Don't use mediation where arbitration should work. Don't use arbitration where conciliation will work. Don't use conciliation where reconciliation will work. Don't use reconciliation where negotiation will work. Identify the one that fits that problem or that conflict and use that. Use that before. This is not really a whole training on this thing. Otherwise, that's usually exercise you do so that you understand how the kind of conflict that you now apply this. Well, let's go now to YouTube. Then step 8, reconcile. As reconciliation takes place, agreement takes place. It will be verbal, it will also be written. Then you do implementation. Do you know that during implementation, conflict also occurs? Are we aware? Do we know that? During implementation, do you know that people renege on what they say they will do?
Yes.
Are we aware?
Yes.
They call it breach. Breach. There are lawyers here, baby. They call it breach. In a contract or in an agreement, they call it a breach. Even after all the things that have been decided, and it was now reduced to an agreement, signed. Countersign, witnesses and all that, we shook hands during the implementation. That one party is still finding a space not to let what has been there. And that's another source of conflict. Next,
A conflict resolution strategy is a plan. Do we understand that now? A conflict resolution strategy is a plan. Don't worry about the big word strategy. The military term. Conflict resolution strategy is a plan. It's a plan. You must choose the appropriate mechanism for the resolution of the conflicts. Choose the one that is appropriate. These are the ones we have identified here for the purpose of this presentation.
Litigation. Do you know that litigation is a method of resolving conflicts?